You know, this might be some of the best, if not the best, damage control I have ever seen. Yes, just an hour or so ago, many of us were furious. I tweeted out about it myself, that Warner Brothers, it seemed, was not going to be presenting in Hall H this year at Comic-Con. And DC has so much potentially to present. And as I tweeted, they've won Comic-Con the last few years. So why would they not even compete this year? And sure enough, Patty Jenkins simultaneously confirmed that they won't be in Hall H, but also, as I said, did tremendous damage control by giving us a glorious teaser poster for Wonder Woman 1984. And yes, as I've been mentioning in my member live streams, if you'd like to join me four times a week, you can click the join button down below. But I've been talking about the fact that there are rumblings for a while now that Wonder Woman would indeed don her infamous golden armor in her sequel, because it's never looked this good in the comics. And there it is! Also, I'm always talking about the importance of hair. Do you see what I'm talking about? Her hair is amazing. So amazing. She has, I think Gal Gadot's Wonder Woman has some of the best hair in the history of Hollywood. It's amazing! So yes, the good thing about Warner Brothers not presenting in Hall H this year is that we don't have to wait for big reveals like this one. And on a side note, it seems just like the Super Bowl, studios are deciding they don't need something like Comic-Con, a third-party event, to make a big splash. Just like studios are abandoning Netflix and Apple to create their own spaces. And speaking of creating their own spaces, maybe, and I don't know, this could get awfully expensive for fans, but maybe other studios will create their own fan events like Disney's D23, which started out real weak, but has become a tremendous juggernaut. And I think Warner Brothers, for instance, could create a competing event that would be just as strong. Do it! All right, so anyway, yes, Wonder Woman 1984 is exactly 1 year out. I can't believe it's that far away. Even Patty Jenkins herself has admitted it was a mistake to push the movie back this far. But push it back they did. I hope they've got more exciting stuff like this because they have to drag out this excitement for a year, right? So anyway, this comes out June 5th, 2020. And here's the official teaser poster, which is beautiful. It is stunning. It looks a bit like Big Barda, but that's Warner Brothers for you. We cannibalize one movie for another. Although Wonder Woman's coming first, who knows when the heck we'll get New Gods, if we even do. And Wonder Woman, to be fair, has fought alongside the female Furies from Apocalypse, and this is what she will obviously be wearing, and she'll fit right in. If the female Furies could look this good, I'm excited. But anyway, I have to say, the 1980s were a very distinct and famous period in terms of fine art. Andy Warhol, for instance, right? And I love seeing that reflected in this movie. I made a whole video, and I'll put a link down below in the video description, to the pop culture and historical references that 1984 is rich with, which is the same reason Ryan Murphy is going to be doing something based on 1984 before this movie comes out, because it was pushed back. What a disaster on that front. But if it continues to be this strong, maybe not. Anyway, I'm happy to see that Patty Jenkins seems to be aware of all the rich things that she can draw from for the year. And if she does that effectively in the movie, I think it will elevate the film from an intellectual perspective. It'll be more than just your standard comic book movie, which is so important these days, as there are so many comic book films. She continues, Patty Jenkins, to go the Wonder Woman Barbie route with this movie. This looks like a collector's Barbie, right? And I continue to worry that that will limit the audience. This reminds me, this look, of the more conservative yet more powerful look that DC tried to give Poison Ivy a couple of years ago, which did not stick, wasn't popular with the fandom. And I suspect most fans, even female fans, will still gravitate towards the sexier, softer look on display in this other Wonder Woman 1984 artwork. She looks great in both. You know, that's just, again, sexier and softer. And I just ultimately think that will end up being more popular. That's, you know, it's fine. I think this isn't going to be her main look in the movie. It's probably going to be for an exciting third act battle. And it certainly serves to get people's attention and get them talking. So more so than that other look, which of course is a little bit closer to how she looked in the first film, only with the golden tones. And speaking of the golden tones, which you can see in both artwork, I think that's great. I think that it lassos, of course, her golden lasso, but also it helps you tell the two movies apart. I've talked about the importance of that before, being able to, you know, giving movies in a franchise distinct look so that people can visually identify which movie you're talking about instead of being like, which movie is that from again? And so, of course, the teaser poster does that much more so than the banner, but the banner's golden overlay does do that. Now, the other thing that I'm very pleased with here is how much the team here, the hair, makeup, and costume team, is looking out for their star. I just posted my review of Dark Phoenix, and I said that Sophie Turner's team failed her miserably. I mean, she should look this good in Dark Phoenix. Jean Grey, just as exciting and as powerful a character. So let's talk about how good Gal Gadot looks, right? So her hair, fabulous. It's luxurious, it's thick, but it's still also sporty. You don't feel, like she couldn't fight wearing that thing. Ha, I love it. She might eventually put a helmet on, we'll see. But with that hair sticking out from underneath it, it could still look really great. And you'll notice how important the hair would be, even with the helmet on. I love the makeup. I think it looks really fantastic. It's not too overboard. And also, it's not so overcoming that you can still see the play of colors on her face. You can see half of it's a little bit green. I think that looks really fantastic. She's got thumb holes, so I automatically love the suit right there. Thumb holes, so fantastic. I love the boots, by the way. They're also thigh-high boots, even higher than her normal boots. But whereas the first look at the character, they look very much like hooker boots, right? These, I think, they're sexy, but they also really work strongly for the female gaze and high fashion. Gaze, I meant, G-A-Z-E, although I guess it works in both regards. But anyway, I love the way the boot kind of like works up the side of her leg in pieces, you know, the way it's stuck on there. It's not only very flattering, but it's a really cool look as well. Gal Gadot has long legs to begin with, but this elongates them even more. Instead of cutting her legs off, it creates even more of a great visual flow. I'm very impressed. She's got gauntlets, right? I mean, it looks more like a superhero costume, in fact, than a suit of armor. Now, she's had a cape traditionally with her suit of armor in the comics, which again, DC Comics should be like, how do we never make her look this good? Although, of course, they always tried to be more traditional to her Greco-Roman heritage, but they've totally abandoned that here, as you can see. I think I'm all for it, considering how good it looks. Again, as I said, this is more superhero. It even looks a little bit like some of the Phoenix Force looks from Avengers versus X-Men. So, haha! Finally, we get there first on something else. So we took that look because you can see almost like the Phoenix bird with the gold coloring and the chest plate. That reminds me of that a lot as well. But it's just fantastic. But she's had a cape, okay, I'm like just lost in how gorgeous this is. But she's had a cape. She could maybe have a cape here. I could see her being able to take it on and off, or maybe it's ripped off in battle and she's like, I'm still going, haha, it's a tear away. But I'm not sure what color I would want it to be. I wouldn't have it be red. I think that's a little bit too aggressive, but I don't know how about a pinkish red might also be like a little too girly. So maybe she shouldn't have a cape. I mean, I don't know if there's a color, maybe blue. She's had blue in the past and I could see a really nice blue, like her dress in the first film, working out quite nicely. She could also go white. And speaking of white, of course, she has a white dress on in this movie, as we've seen also released from photos from Patty Jenkins, which is a nod to some of Wonder Woman's looks in the classic comics as well. Just fantastic. Absolutely adore it. I think this movie, by the way, Patty Jenkins is really doing a lot of aggressive, inventive, outside of the box stuff here. And I think that she'll be able to get away with it and maybe even be applauded for it as long as this movie has amazing action sequences. I heard behind the scenes that Patty Jenkins got rid of a number of people who worked on the action sequences in the first film because they didn't quite see eye to eye on that. I heard that's why the food court sequence looked, you know, the leaked didn't look quite as good as the first movie. But hopefully they fixed that. They've done extensive reshoots. Maybe that's one of the things they noticed. They were like, fight scenes, need better fight scenes. But I think so far, I think this is the strongest I've actually seen for the film. Presentation wise. So what do you think? Share your thoughts down below. If anyone has anything negative to say about this, I would be really curious to hear your reasoning. All right, so share your thoughts down below. And of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.